Tonight we begin, continue with the Song of Awakening. Yongjia, Chan Master Yongjia. I'll read the passages for this section and provide some comments. Okay. So we're actually on the section regarding practice. We've already discussed correct views, right? And these passages deal with the actual working end of embodying the views. So the text reads, if you regard criticism as merit, the critics will become spiritual friends. Do not hate those who slander you. How else can you manifest the unborn power of compassionate forbearance? This is the verse. I'll comment on that first. The next two set of verses are selected. They're not. They don't follow directly what I just read, so I skipped some. The next few verses are post-awakening practice. But the verse that I just read concludes the part about practicing before awakening. And this is what it takes. Is that difficult? Yeah. When everything is going smooth, we feel great about our practice. We love our practice. But when things are not going smooth, when you're being blamed, when you're being criticized, when you face obstacles, how should practitioners regard them? Here it says spiritual friends. The technical word is Kalyana Mitra. Kalyana Mitra. There are many types of Kalyana Mitra. Those that give advice, give us the teachings, Buddha Dharma, people that are reliable, support our practice. Usually people consider those Kalyana Mitra, like your teacher, right? Teaches Buddha Dharma. Twice a month, Monday nights, they give Dharma talks. But there's a special type of Kalyana Mitra that is highly privileged by Bodhisattva practitioners. And they are those who, they're not there to support your practice. They're there to challenge you. And they may hate practice. They may criticize you for engaging in practice. They may be the ones causing harm to you or others. They are the ones that get under our skin. They know exactly which button to push, and they exercise that power quite frequently. Have you met those people before? Yeah. Sometimes it's in a workplace, sometimes it's family members. Right. I'm not going to ask you a question to raise hands, tell me which one. All of us have these type of spiritual friends. Why is it? that they are friends. From the conventional perspective, we go through our lives imperceptibly categorizing, compartmentalizing all those who we meet into three types. Each type, there are a vast array of degrees. So, people that are beneficial to us, help us, support us, we categorize them as friends. People that obstructs us, challenges us, gets under our skin, we categorize them as foe. These are simplistic terms. And there's a whole range of experiences that we have, the way we label them, compartmentalize them. And then there is a whole category of people that we don't really care, strangers. We don't feel a connection to them. This is the conventional understanding. But unfortunately, conventional understanding perpetuates our suffering. What do I mean by that? Conventional understandings perpetuate the self, self-referentiality, self-preservation. It's not to say that Buddhism does not teach about self-regard, self-compassion. Of course they do. But here, most of the views that we have, shared values and meanings that we place on people, events, things that we've learned from our child rearing process, from our family members, our friends, maybe school, maybe the particular region, whether it is upper middle class or the slums, impoverished area. We've acquired certain values and we assign, attribute meaning to them. And much of those actually perpetuates polarizing views that sustains suffering. Polarizing view means this is good, this is bad. She's good, he's bad. He's good, she's bad. They are bad, we are good. So us versus them, they versus me. The root of this, what fuels this, is desire. The flip side of desire is aversion. Yeah. Through the lens of desire and aversion, we experience the world as separate, divided, segregated. We don't see things as interdependent. We see things as having fixed, discrete identities. That's why it causes suffering. So, in that context, of course, people that obstructs us, criticizes us, whether it is valid or not. Often it's not. It's just misunderstanding. How do we feel about those people? Forget about learned knowledge concepts like this text here that tell us we should treat them like spiritual friends, see them as spiritual friends. Forget about that. How do we actually feel about that? How do we feel? Right. If we had a soundtrack, it would be like, like, you know, like those murder films. That's how we feel. Our defenses. And we feel it in the body. We feel it in the body. Like sometimes, people criticize us. I feel like something is just drained out of us, Especially something that we love, And you see this in kids, They did a wonderful drawing of something, of someone, but it looks totally different. It looks like, what the, you look at it and say, oh, it's not, you can improve it. And just like, oh. It just kind of drops, So there's intuition of self-preservation, of protecting me, I, mine. The perception of threats. There's a biological component to it. But it's not that there are real threats out there, because the reality is someone's threat could be someone's lover, best friend. So we're really coming down to perception. If you learn that, criticism actually helps us grow. Or it's not a threat. It's good for us. Then this whole biological, neurological system would not act up when we experience that. Or we have a different relationship with ourselves, a different relationship with others. The perception would change. Do you agree? No. But this relationship has a history. The way we were raised, the way we grow up, the conditions that we find ourselves. The emotions that we feel, they indicate to us as practitioners the areas that we need to work on. They reveal to us the path. The path. There are some people, their kind of karmic disposition or conditioning is such that their survival mechanism is to please people, is to support and be helpful to people. So what devastates them, what really hurts them, is they find that they're not helpful, that they are maybe hurting other people. There are others who are very intelligent and very rational. They've not learned to connect to other people through their feelings, a sense of connection. They learn to relate to people on a very rational, reasonable level. So, you know, sometimes when these people, when they see something that's less than intelligent, or they interact with people that are always make mistakes, you know, wrong choices, and they very impatient. They can't stand it. Yeah. Everything is so clear to them. But why can't you see that? Yeah. Do you know such people? Yeah. There are all types of people. Some people, they the way for them to be relevant is to make everyone laugh. It's a kind of distraction. They distract the topic. They distract tension. And you can't pin them down to do something, commit to something serious. So when they experience tension, criticism, they, you know, first want to laugh at themselves, or they make a joke out of it. You know, but they really can't face. They can't face that. It's too hurtful. They've learned that by making everyone laugh, things will be okay. So no matter what ways we find ourselves, what position, we can only discover that through meeting obstacles. When things are going smooth, we think everything's okay. But when we encounter difficulties, then we discover how we relate to ourselves, how we relate to other people. And that is precious. That is precious. Because practice is about relationship. Relating to ourselves, relating to others. But for many people, life is not about practice. They're not Dharma practitioners. Even for Dharma practitioners, when they're at the center, and everything is going good, you know, the environment is beautiful, supportive, but when they go back home, they're a completely different person. Yeah. And when they encounter difficulties in life, it's hard to remember that I'm a practitioner. So the very first step we should do is remind ourselves that we're practitioners. Why should we practice? Some people are still on the fence about practice. You know, they find Buddhism interesting, relaxing, especially the meditation part. That's just the very tip of the iceberg. They haven't discovered the full potential of who they are, the full potential of Buddha Dharma. And they're just engaging practice to satisfy some aspect of themselves that they want to escape from, you know, escape from difficulties, troubles, families, you know, friends. So they're just here to get that dose of dopamine, you know, serotonin. Yeah. So I say the first step is to really realize that we're practitioners. So we really have to come to some embodied understanding, experience of the value of practice. The value and the meaningfulness of practice. recognizing that we are made up of everyone else. We belong to everyone. We belong to the world. The world sustains us. So for us to run away from the world, however way we do it, is to not face who we really are. And the real value and meaning of practice come from facing ourselves. And having the courage, despite the difficulties, the challenges, that we're able to bring forth the inconceivable resources and strength to continue. And this is so much greater than our own little circle of family and friends, the meaning that we create, that we are able to benefit so many people through our practice. And we were to bring out so much resources within ourselves to face and support others. That is truly meaningful. So that is the kind of one side of it. This, what we typically call Bodhi mind, right? Bodhicitta. The recognition that we are supported by all, that we are giving back the nourish that we receive from everything, that everyone in our lives, past, present, future. The other side of it is this recognition that we have so much potential for freedom because we're already free. That was the view that was discussed in the earlier section. Vexations, emotional afflictions, anguish that we feel do not define us. Even our skills, knowledge, experience do not define us. What defines us is this potential, this freedom. So that's the other side, the wisdom aspect. Many terms the Buddha calls this. Buddha nature, Tathagatagarbha, the nirvanic nature within all beings. So recognizing that, kind of grounding ourselves in this, that will give us strength, that we're practitioners. We're practitioners. There's so much we can do to benefit our friends, our family, those around us, instead of constantly protecting ourselves. There's no need to protect ourselves. We're already free. Nothing can hurt us. No criticism can hurt us. What about life-threatening stuff? Life-threatening stuff cannot hurt us. They cannot hurt the freedom. That's the source of our strength. That's the source of our courage. Wisdom of emptiness, freedom. Compassion of interconnectedness. Once we establish this, it's good to, upon hearing this, to reflect upon the interconnectedness and the freedom that we have, the choice that we have, and then put it into practice. Then we can remind ourselves that we're practitioners when we face criticism. Otherwise, if that foundation is not strong, then we can waver. Yes, I'm a practitioner, but he's a jerk. I don't want to see this person. I want to get away from this person. Or these people, they don't deserve it. Yes, I'm a practitioner. So what? I have my rights too. All the way that we justify, right? So that shows that What ticks us off is our path, is our limitations. It shows us how we are conditioned in a particular way. Some people, they can only go on and continue when they're supported. Most people are like that. They feel seen, they feel heard, they feel loved, and they feel supported, and they can bring out, they're able to flourish. And when they're criticized, they're devastated. So, remind ourselves, why is it that I'm devastated? Why is it that I lose hope? Why is it that I want to give up? So, give you some example. In my life, many occasions I want to give up. Many occasions. Give up on what? Give up on Bodhi mind, Bodhisattva path. I remember, and it's not like the beginning of the practice. I want to give up when I was well into practice, right? When I received sanction from my teacher of entering the door to Chan, age 26. The first 26 of my life, 26 years, living a dream. Now I'm double that. I'm talking about the latter half. I remember sometimes looking out on retreats, at retreatants, assisting my teacher. We used to go all over the place. Just looking the way they sit, and they struggle, and the way, day three, they're coming for interview, problem solved, everything's good, they energize, day four, everything go to waste. Or day five, everything we taught out the window. It's like, it's hopeless. I'm sorry. And I felt, and I feel like, I said, Shifu, what's the point? The sentient being is just suffering. They do stuff that create their suffering. Perpetuate it. How? By following their ruminations. Sometimes, people have very strange ideas. We don't know exactly where those ideas come from. Very strange. And then they're just sucked into that vortex. A common example is doing everything well, practicing, and all of a sudden a wandering thought, I don't think this is for me. Where did that thought come from? They were doing very well. This is not really for me. I should be out there in the world, whatever. Then their whole course changes. It's amazing. It's amazing. Or sometimes some people have think, this person, it's actually manipulating me. That person may be not even thinking about you, right? Just like blah, 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 say something. And then our whole actions, very strange. Where did they come from? Where did these thoughts come from? There's a reason for everything. There's a reason for it. These are vexations. There's a subtle undercurrent feeling tone of the workings of vexations and triggers that they manifest. They reveal your path. Don't follow it. Don't follow that. You know, you can't possibly, you know. I've had students that say, you know, Guo Gu is authoritarian. Just crazy idea to come up. Guo Gu is authoritarian? Anyone who knows me, knows. I don't even vote. I let all the board members vote. You know, it's like, what? Strange idea to come up. And they follow that, and they criticize. Do I get offended? Am I affected? You bet you I get affected. Shut off the alarm, please. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. I get affected? I don't get that affected, but I get affected. Do I get affected? Sometimes I understand. Because I've experienced that. You know, strange thoughts just come. And then I just get sidetracked, you know? These karmic habit tendencies are deeply, deeply ingrained. Having some awakening experience is not going to, it's not going to take care of that. You know? To practice again and again and again and again. The teacher-student relationship, it's like that. You know? So, we offer our life, offer ourselves for the student. And whatever causes and conditions, sometimes it's both parties, just there's some karma that needs to be worked out. But we should recognize that if this path is wholesome, then we should continue to the end if this relationship is wholesome. We should continue to the end, no matter how difficult it may be. The people presenting difficulty to you, whether it's a teacher, I do that. Right? Whether it's a teacher or a friend or a critic, helps us unpack our karmic baggage. And it's time to dig through, vent out, give air, and then work through them. Some of the stuff in your luggage, just donate it. Goodwill. You don't need it anymore. Someone else can use it. Something you need to mend, and then you can use it again. Well, I understand. A lot of times, for example, you know, students, I've had a few, you know, leave. It's difficult for them. The practice of Chan, I don't sugarcoat practice. It's very difficult. Practice is about facing our vexations, excavate, and then embrace them, work through them. Then you can let go. It's not about blissing out. It's not about, you know, everything's so happy, and compassion, everything. Compassion to yourself, how you face your own vexations. Right? So, you know, when students, I understand what they need to do sometimes is to turn around and put the fault at me. So that justifies that they can leave. You know what I'm saying? So I take it. I take it. You know, But beyond, you know, teacher-student relationship, we have all kinds of relationship. It is through relationships, family, very difficult, entangling, love and hate, you know, good and bad, pleasant memories, unpleasant memories, you know, when the borders are blurred, our vexations come out, when we're not on guard. So they provide excellent occasions for practice. We have to remind ourselves, we're practitioners. This is my path. He, she, they are my path. They show exactly my shortcomings. What gets me, how do you say that expression? Gets under my skin? Yeah. So, Kalyana Mitra. Now some people think, you know, I'm able to see all beings as my virtuous spiritual guides, spiritual friends. They don't realize that they're the one giving hard time to other people. They just kind of turn it around like, you know, all you guys giving me difficulties, you know, my bodhisattva, I'm such a good practitioner. But then the little things that they do, the nagging that they do, the criticism that they think, the look that they have, the way they carry themselves, sometimes brings vexations. So they are the source of other people's vexations. Like, we may be the source of other people's vexations. You know, that is something to repent for. I remember one time I was driving with my mom when my mom was still alive. She was a practitioner. She was like one of those super Asian moms. You know? She has the ferocious energy to practice. But that energy, if you tick her off the wrong way, it becomes the ferocious, wrathful deity. Come on, you know, with all the armors, you know. So what ticked her off was when we first came to America, I remember like two instances I'll give you. You know, my mom, great, but, you know, not too good of a driver. So I remember coming to America first time. And I didn't know what flipping you off with the bird means, right? So my mom's driving, and then the person's flipping us off, like, ah, God. And I was like, I think something's on our roof, mom. Like, the person keep on pointing at our roof. Something, you know, we should stop the car. And my mom's like, no, they're not. And she's like yelling at them back. We've been practicing for some time. I was young. I was like 11. And a decade later, I was already practicing. I was a serious practitioner. And I was driving. And something happened. I did something. I didn't see the person coming. And the person was really like, they didn't flip me off, but they were, you can tell they were angry, driving back. Because I did something wrong. Sometimes, like, how do you feel? Sometimes we get wild up. We get, I mean, that's right. Yeah, I made a mistake. So what? You know, or something, you know, some people do that. But I saw that and I was like, oh. My mom was all riled up, ready to go. And I said, what are you doing? She's like, that person, you know, we did something wrong, yes, but that person sped up and cut us off right in front. You know, like what I did to him, because I didn't see him. That was a mistake. So they want to show me, just, you know, see how that feels, you know. So I was like, sorry. And my mom was really, you know, we feel justified sometimes, you know. Yes, I made a mistake. We don't have to do that, you know. So my mom was really wound up, and I became very quiet. She said, what's wrong with you? I said, I became the source of that person's vexations. I just caused that. And when she saw that, she was like, she calmed down. So sometimes we have to be aware. It's one thing to see other people as virtuous spiritual friends. Sometimes we have to see if we are the critic. Yeah. So when we discover that we are the cause of, it doesn't matter if you mean it or not, it doesn't really matter. It doesn't really matter. We're the cause of someone else's vexations. We're the critic. They don't see us as spiritual friend. We just cause that person further the karma. So repent. Now, sometime in teaching, I press students, encourage them, and I critique them. I show them their vexations. You know, you say, that's creating people's vexations, students. That doesn't count. You know, there's no vexations here. I'm showing you. Well, if the students see that, they have to learn from this. Right? So all of our reactions show us our limitations. And it's, I have to practice. Just recently I was affected. We're promoting Dharma relief too, and healing racial relations. This is Dharma Relief is another non-profit organization that I run. And for that Dharma Relief too, we're amplifying Black Dharma teachers. But many of the teachers that we work with are other practitioners. It takes a long time. It takes a long time to build trust, especially during the pandemic. We never met. We only met through Zoom. So many of them have lived their lives being taken advantage of. Manipulated, exploited. So it's no wonder there's distrust or doubt, suspicion. So it takes a long time. And patience. Even when you know what needs to be done. You can't do what can be done. I often say, what needs to be done, what can be done, we do it. What can be done, sometimes you can't do it. Causes and conditions are not ripe. So we have to wait. We have to create new causes and conditions to move forward Sometimes you're not a person to do it. It takes another person to do it, right? To suggest ideas, come up with plans. Do you know what I'm saying? So working with causes and conditions. Recognizing limitations, you know, shortcomings. And recently we had a Galen Roshi from Houston Zen Center visit us, give us a talk. She talks about this in terms of edges, right? Finding the edges, which is what I've been talking about, limitations, boundaries, shortcomings. When we recognize that, that's where the path starts to unfold. Even when you recognize that, the workings of causes and conditions, sometimes it's not ripe, it's not ready. There's delay. It takes patience. It takes working again, again, and again to build that. Very difficult. Very difficult. Is it worth it? Yes, because this project, initiative is worth the time, is worth our effort, and it has the potential of benefiting numerous communities. Communities. By the way, you can take a look at it. Dharma relief. Healing racial relations. Support it. Okay, spread the word. So, critics become spiritual friends. Something you can't buy. Those people that only praise you, yes. They help us when we are at the weakest. When we are at the weakest, when we are young, we need to learn how to walk. They help pick us up. You can't rely on that all the time, even when we're grown up. Just surround ourselves with only people that support you, praise you, nice to you. That's no way to live. You're living a bubble. Real growth, real resources from the depth of our being come from difficulties. Yeah. We can come up with all kinds of reasons, you know, to avoid that. But does that mean we don't change social relations? We don't address injustice? Of course not. Of course not. We change the world. We make the world better. We offer ourselves for the benefit of all. But we do so as a practitioner that do not perpetuate suffering, polarizing views. Because that will always end up with more suffering. Right? Criminals, do we put them in jail? Yes. But we don't, you know, beat them up on the way. They're already locked up. Beat them up on the way to the jail. Let the justice system. And if the justice system needs to change, policy needs to change, change. We make change. We support the change. But when there's vexations present, the choices will lead to suffering. And trust me, other people around us pick it up. They may not consciously know it, but when you're vexed, their defenses are up. And they will do things that they don't want to do. They don't even know. Like, they have their survival mechanisms. Some of them will please you. Some of them will rationalize. Some of them will fight with you. Just a vicious cycle. So, when we don't have the resources to do this, it's not that we always embrace, we wait. Right? Four types of working with causes and conditions that I always say. Right? Recognize, adapt, wait, and create. And you wait. Distance yourself from this bodhisattva. You can't handle this person. Okay, distance yourself. And then come back later. You know, we have to practice self-regard, self-compassion, strong. surround ourselves with supportive practitioners, right? Until we're strong enough, until the difficult people, the challenges in life becomes just as powerful resources, just as powerful support, like the people that love you, listen to you. That. Then, the last line, you will manifest the unborn power of compassionate forbearance. Compassion without enemies. Compassion without opposition. That will start to manifest. Where working through relationships, which is life, which is practice, working through relationships, we discover inexhaustible ability to embrace everything and engage in change without entertaining, that comes later, only after awakening, without entertaining notions of, you know, me who is enduring, they who are my bodhisattvas, and our interactions as transactions, exchange, as some kind of thing. You know? Like they're helping me, or I'm helping them. All these will change after awakening. If you still hold ideas of sentient beings out there, I must save all beings, and they're my bodhisattvas, then, you know, it's still us versus them. You know, these things will start to dissolve. That's why it's the unborn. What is it that's unborn? Self and others. Unborn. Right? Self and others. Do we engage in actions? Yes. So, me, I, mine, in addition, they, them, you know, dissolve. So, vexations, unborn. Compassion without vexations. Just four lines. Okay, I'll reserve the post-awakening practice for next time. I'll read it. Just to plant the seed, the hook. Okay, the text continues. This is a I'm skipping a few lines. I'm just drawing out the most important ones. There's no need for further effort after awakening. I said, what? But Guo Gu just talks about continual practice, continual awakening. Yeah, I'll explain it. Why? There's no need for further effort after awakening, which is different than all conditioned phenomena. Giving alms with attachment leads to the merit of a heavenly birth. But doing so is like shooting an arrow into the sky. Come right. Not seeking the true, not rejecting the false, realizing that both are empty without form. No form, not emptiness, not non-emptiness. This is the true reality of Tathagata, which is the Buddha. So we'll deal with these two next time.